In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Good morning and welcome to the St. Vincent Archabbey Basilica on behalf of our prior, Father Earl, and our rector, Father Edward, our college president, Brother Norman, and the entire St. Vincent community. I extend a warm welcome to all of our seminary alumni and friends who gather here today for this 71st annual Priest Day celebration. This is always a wonderful day when we get a chance to come together to renew friendships, to become updated on what we've all been doing, and also to be renewed in our own commitment to Christ, and also pray together for the grace of perseverance and also gratitude for the blessing of the calling which we have received. I do want to extend a special welcome to Bishop Bartchak, Bishop Molesik, and Bishop Winter, who join us today for their presence and also for the inspiring leadership that they offer to us. So I look forward to visiting with all of you throughout the course of this day. And again, welcome to St. Vincent. God's blessings.
Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who consecrated the first fruits of your apostles by the blood of St. James, grant, we pray, that your church may be strengthened by his confession of faith and constantly sustained by his protection. Through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew. The mother of the sons of Zebedee approached Jesus with her sons and did him homage, wishing to ask him for something. He said to her, "What do you wish?" She answered him, "Command that these two sons of mine sit one at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." Jesus said in reply, "You do not know what you are asking. Can you drink the chalice that I am going to drink?" They said to him, "We can." He replied, "My chalice you will indeed drink, but to sit at my right and at my left, this is not mine to give, but is for those for whom it has been prepared by my Father." When the 10 heard this, they became indignant at the two brothers. But Jesus summoned them and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their great ones make their authority over them felt. But it shall not be so among you. Rather, whoever wishes to be great among you shall be your servant. Whoever wishes to be first among you shall be your slave. Just so, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." The Gospel of the Lord.
Archabbey Douglas, thank you for the invitation to celebrate this Mass and to preach at this Mass for the Priest Day. It's always good to be here at St. Vincent Archabbey with you and your brother monks, and also with my friends Bishop Malesic and Bishop Winter. My homily, brothers, is especially directed to the priests here, and I hope everyone else who is also with us don't mind if I especially reflect with them, because after all, this is the annual Priest Day. A priest friend of mine from the Archdiocese of Boston shared this little story with me one time. It's about a young executive from Boston who was applying for a job at a bank in Chicago, and the Chicago bank asked for a letter of recommendation from his current employer in Boston, and a vice president from the bank in Boston promptly replied by letter. And this letter tended to highlight the pedigree of this young executive. And this is what it said. "I trust that you are aware that the applicant comes from an extended family that includes many of the most prestigious names in our city. His father was a Cabot, his mother was a Lowell, and further back was a happy blend of Peabody's and other first families of Boston." And the letter concluded by saying, "The applicant for the position is recommended without qualification." The Chicago bank sent a response very quickly, which indicated that the information in the letter of recommendation was totally inadequate for their request. And it read, "We are not contemplating using the young man for breeding purposes, just for work." The story came to mind, I know my mind sometimes gets carried away, but it came to mind as I was reflecting on Matthew's account of the unsolicited recommendation made by the mother of James and John on behalf of her sons. Matthew describes that the mother was polite and respectful in showing homage as she approached Jesus. And Matthew tells us that she approached because she wished to ask Jesus for something. Now, of course, the text sounds more like a demand than a request when she says, "I want you to command that these two sons of mine sit, one at your right and the other on your left, in your kingdom." Of course, none of us in our ministry has ever encountered a woman who approached us with that kind of forceful request. Interestingly, the Lord Jesus is direct in his response. He doesn't ask, "Are you sure about that?" Instead, he says to the mother, "You don't know what you're talking about. You don't know what you're asking." I can only imagine what that mother might have been thinking at that particular moment. Maybe it was something like this: "Lord, you just know how proud I am of my two boys. You know them. They were among the first group of the apostles that you call together. They quit the family business to follow you. I know that you're fond of them. You even gave them that nickname, Sons of Thunder." What do you think the odds are that the mother had something to do with the thunder part of that nickname? The mother was restating their pedigree, but Jesus was interested in talking about the work. The work that comes with being a disciple and an apostle. That's made clear when Jesus asks, "Can you drink the chalice that I am going to drink?" Of course, James and John said to him, "We can." It's no small thing that Jesus affirms their response. Many have suggested that, especially for St. James, whose feast we celebrate today, his response would be borne out by the fact that he is the first of the 12 apostles to be reported to have been martyred, as we know from the Acts of the Apostles. At the end of today's gospel reading, Jesus reminded James and John, and he reminds all of us, about his identity. Above all, as a servant, a suffering servant. On a day like this annual priest day, it is a grace for us to come together to reflect on how we are doing with the ways in which we share and partake of the chalice of Jesus, which is a symbol of passion and suffering. On a day like this annual priest day, and in view of some of the challenges facing the church in our times, including scandals, it is a grace for us to be reminded that our sharing in the chalice of Christ is not simply a matter of spiritual or physical or emotional suffering. For sure, all of that can be part of the equation. It's part of human experience. But we need to remember that it is not about our pedigree. What I mean is that there is a danger in any circumstance that we should think that we are to be the suffering servant of God. In doing that, we run the risk of trying to put ourselves on the same level with Christ, the Lord Jesus, and it's his to decide, not ours. He says only the Father can make that call. On a day like this annual priest day, it is a grace and blessing to be reminded that there is one suffering servant who accomplished the work of salvation through his death and resurrection. Yes, we are to drink from the Lord's chalice. But when we do that in the sacrifice of the Mass and in the reception of the body and blood, we must do it with the conviction, first and above all, that Christ Jesus, has saved the world. We are the beneficiaries of that gift of salvation. By sharing his chalice and by sharing in and receiving his body and blood, soul and divinity, the very person of our Lord Jesus Christ becomes the only pedigree that we need or should ever want in our lives. On a day like this annual priest day, it is a grace and blessing to be reminded that our work is all about announcing, revealing the person of Jesus to everyone we meet.
Pope Francis puts it this way in his apostolic exhortation, The Joy of the Gospel. In case you want to remember what paragraph, it's number 268. And here's the quote. He says, we need to develop a spiritual taste for being close to people's lives and to discover that this is itself a source of greater joy. Mission is at once a passion for Jesus and a passion for his people. When we stand before Jesus crucified, we see the depth of his love, which exalts and sustains us. But at the same time, unless we are blind, we begin to realize that Jesus' gaze, burning with love, expands to embrace all his people. We realize once more that he wants to make use of us to draw closer to his beloved people. He takes us from the midst of his people, and he sends us to his people. Without this sense of belonging, we cannot understand our deepest identity. End of quote. So it is not for us to be concerned today or any day whether we will be at the right or the left hand of Christ, because it's simply all about accompanying the Lord Jesus. It's about accompanying each other who have been called to the ordained ministry of the priesthood. It's about accompanying the persons who have been entrusted to our care. And most especially, it's always about being aware that the Lord Jesus began accompanying us, each one of us, even before we were aware of him. And the same Lord Jesus accompanies us today and tomorrow and the next. All this, including the faithful life and ministry of St. James the Apostle, is what St. Paul was getting at in today's reading from 2 Corinthians. These are St. Paul's words. He says, we hold this treasure in earthen vessels, that the surpassing power may be of God and not from us. We are afflicted in every way, but not constrained, perplexed, but not driven to despair, persecuted, but not abandoned, struck down, but not destroyed, always carrying about in the body the dying of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be manifested in our body. For we who live are constantly being given up to death for the sake of Jesus Christ, so that the life of Jesus may be manifested in our mortal flesh. St. Paul concludes by reminding us that even as we recognize that death is at work in us, life is also within us. That life first received in baptism and directed in a unique way through the sacrament of holy orders is not our way of life. It is not a way of life to be requested or to be demanded, at least in the sense of the proud mother of those sons of thunder. It is nothing less than a sharing in the life and the ministry of the Lord Jesus, the suffering servant, the good shepherd, and the high priest. All of us accepted that share in his life and ministry on the day of our ordination. On this annual priest day, I'd invite you to renew your commitment to that vocation. Never be afraid to ask Jesus what you need at any given moment of your life. Today's gospel story and the story of St. James the Apostle, whose ministry and life we celebrate today, they remind us that God listens and responds to us always in truth and with love.
Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, peace I leave you, my peace I give you, look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit.
Let us offer each other a sign of peace. Peace to others. Thank you. Peace be with you, Ed. Peace be with you, Bill.
Peace, Mark. Thank you.
Peace, Max. Let us pray. Help us, O Lord, we pray, through the intercession of the blessed Apostle James, on whose feast day we have received with joy your holy gifts, through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And with you.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Our help is in the name of the Lord.
Amen.
May Almighty God bless you, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Go forth, the Mass is ended.
Amen.